event. For example, if I consider a sinus tachycardia, so if the sinus tachycardia rate increases and the rate goes into the VT zone, the device will detect a sinus tachycardia as a VT and then deliver a therapy. So SVT discrimination helps in discriminating a detected rhythm and withhold therapies for those that are supraventricular and foraging. So that is what we will be discussing about, the SVT discriminators which are available in our devices and the key concepts on what they work, right? So as you can see on the screen, there are two rhythms. On the top, it is like a sinus tachycardia with a narrow QRS, and the bottom rhythm represents a VT with a broad QRS. So the whole purpose, the whole objective of SVT discriminators is to prevent the inappropriate therapies for the SVT arrhythmias. Now, looking at this example, what do we consider? Is it a VT or is it an SVT, right? We generally apply the logic of rate, then we look at the R waves and the P waves. We also look at the relationship between the P and R. On basis of this, we decide whether this is a VT or a SVT, right? So similarly, ICD also applies the same using the digital characteristics of the EGM to identify an SVT. For safety purpose, let's say if the device is unable to call an arrhythmia as an SVT, it will end up giving a therapy for the betterment of the patient. And on a second circumstances, let's say if a device withholds the arrhythmia, saying that it is an SVT, but it will still continuously monitor the same rhythm for any change. So as we see here, SVT discriminator evaluates the following characteristics, that is, on the basis of the nature of the onset of the arrhythmia, it determines. Second is the relationship between the P and the R waves. Third is based on the waveform morphology. And finally, the regularity of the arrhythmic rate. So we'll look into these discriminators and understand their concept. So all these four discriminators are available in the dual chamber ICDs as well as CRTDs. In the single chamber ICD, all are there except PR logic. So I'll first start with the wavelet. Wavelet works on the rhythm morphology. So as we compare both the morphology here, they appear different. Right? In the first rhythm is for the normal sinus rhythm, whereas the second is a VT. So the morphology of the SVT are often similar to those that of normally conducted rhythms, whereas the morphology of the ventricular is completely different from the normally conducted rhythms. So wavelet actually collects a template during the sinus rhythm. It then compares the stored template with the current EGM morphology, right? So it stores a template and then it matches with the ongoing arrhythmia. As seen here, it assigns a match score in the percentage and calls a complex as a match if this match score is equal to or more than 70, as seen in this particular image. As you can see on the right side, it says no match with the 40%. That means it is below the match threshold, which is nominally set at 70. So on basis of this, it determines whether it's an SVT or a VT. So the criteria is, it will, on reaching the NID, it will look back 8 beats, and if it finds that at least three or more of the eight beats is showing a match criteria, then it will withhold the therapy. It will say that this is an SVT. If it finds that less than 3 of the 8 match, then it will go ahead and give the therapy. So in this example, the device looks back 8 and then it sees the match score. So in this, all the 8 beats shows that it is match. All are above 70%. So the device withholds the detection and it marks here as WV, which says that this particular arrhythmia is being withheld because of the feature named wavelet, right? This is a programmer screen where we can see the wavelet, right? This is, we just have to click on, and while doing this, you will go to a next window, which where you can program the match threshold, which is nominally set at 70%. And these templates are can be collected automatically by the device, or we can create one manually. Specifically for CRTD patients or CRTD devices, we prefer doing a manual template collection. This SVT limit represents that the wavelet will be applied up to any rhythm which is above 260 milliseconds. If the rate are faster than this, then the wavelet will not be applied. So this blue box indicates that the wavelet will be applied within this SVT limit. So going to the PR logic. So PR logic, as the name says, PR represents pattern and rate. So this is available in our dual chamber ICDs as well as CRTDs. This is not there in the single chamber ICD because it requires inputs from the atrial EGM as well. So it works on these four criteria. It looks at rate, it looks at pattern of A and B, it looks at the regularity of the ventricular intervals, and also the AV dissociation, right? So if we consider this example, the RV tip to RV ring EGM, you see the ventricular rates are higher compared to the atrial EGM, E tip to A ring. So this can be a possible ventricular tachyarrhythmia. Also, if you look at the onset of this rhythm, this is how generally a week occurs, which is quite abrupt, right? Which is quite sudden. So this is how the algorithm decides. Upon meeting the rate criteria and NID, it will check for the median ventricular rate. If it is faster than the SVT limit, then it will go. If it is yes, then it will go ahead and do the initial VTVF detection. If it is not, then it will look for the AV dissociation. Are the dissociated A and V arrhythmias? If yes, it will go ahead with the detection. If no, then it will look for whether the rhythm is SVT. If it is yes, it will withheld the detection. And if it is no, it will go ahead and get the detection and then therapy. So where do we find this again? On the same programming screen. Above the wavelet, we have PR logic. So there are three different distinct features of PR logic that can be programmed on. One is A for atrial fibrillation and atrial flutter. Second is for sinus tachycardia. And third is for other 1:1 SVTs. Similarly, the SVT limit also applies to the PR logic. Up to any rhythm above 260 milliseconds, PR logic will be applied. So I'll just briefly explain how this different features work. So as you can see here, these are the images actually from the programmer screen. So here you see the plot diagram where the pink dots represent the ventricular rate. The blue box represents the atrial rate. On the left side, the rates are described in the interval, milliseconds. So as we can clearly see that the atrial rates are faster compared to the ventricular rates, and also they are quite irregular, right? And if you want to look into the EGM part of the same episode, so it gives us a detailed explanation. This, the top EGM is the atrial EGM, the second EGM is the ventricular EGM. By looking at it also, we can make out that the number of A is more than the number of R. Also, the R is a little irregular, and the ratio between P and R is also, P is higher than the R. So with this definition, the device calls this as an AF and withhelds the detection for this particular episode. So at the bottom marker channel, you will see AF for this particular episode. Now looking at the second example, first, if you look at the plot again, the atrial rates are faster than the ventricular rate. somewhere the ventricular rates are regular, but sometimes it is irregular. And then if you look at the EGM of the same episode, we can see that the atrial rates are higher than the ventricle, but for every ventricular interval, we see two P waves, which is quite consistent. So this allows the device to call this out as an atrial. The device will detect the therapy, withhold the detection for this particular therapy. Third is the sinus tachycardia. So this feature identifies sinus tachycardia and withholds detection when there is one-to-one atrial to ventricular conduction that exhibits a gradual increase in the rate into the detection zone and a PR interval similar to that of the normal integrate conduction. So if we look at this example, again, it shows the same thing, the plot. There is one-to-one conduction, but it is gradually going into the VT zone. And then it also looks at the PR interval. So PR interval either gradually changes or it remains same. So based on this, the device says that it's a sinus tachycardia and it will withhold the therapy and it will give a marker of ST, which denotes it is withholding due to the sinus tachycardia. This other 1:1 tachycardia feature, it identifies other 1:1 SVT where the atrial and the ventricular activation occurs simultaneously. For example, the junctional rhythm such as AVNRT. So in this case, the atrial and the ventricular depolarization is almost happening simultaneously. So device looks at this pattern for other 1:1 criteria feature. And if you look at the plot, initially the rhythm was 1:1, but there was an abrupt change in the rate, even though both the atrial and the ventricle rate abruptly changed and it went into the VT zone. Here also you see that they are going following 1:1. So for that, the device will mark as an SV, which withheld because of the other 1:1 SVT criteria. One important consideration that we should make while programming this other 1:1 SVT on is that we should not turn it on unless the atrial lead has matured. The reason being, consider if the atrial lead dislodges and it migrates to the ventricle, the feature could inappropriately withhold the detection for a true VT, right? Because both the lead would be sensing the ventricular signals and then the device can inappropriately withhold the detection for this true arrhythmia. Also, device is able to detect the double tachycardia basis on atrial and the ventricular rate, whether A rate is faster than the V rate, is there any association between the two, and then the presence of AF. So if we clearly look here in the plot diagram, the atrial rate is faster than the ventricle, A rate is quite irregular, even the ventricular rate is quite regular here, and then if we compare the association there, we can say that they are completely dissociated in this particular case. And then we look into the EGM, so we also kind of see that the atrial are more than the ventricular beats. And at the bottom, the device says that it is VT plus SVT. Now, why the device called it as a VT? Because the VT rate was quite regular in this particular example. And if you see, the device has given burst, then it gave a ramp therapy, it gave two shocks, and after the second shock, the arrhythmia stopped, right? It went back to the normal sinus rhythm zone. So when this PR logic and wavelet functions together, so PR logic will review the arrhythmia first, and if it is able to find out that PR logic holds detection, so it says yes. If it is unable to identify whether the arrhythmia is an SVT or not, Then upon reaching the NID, and if the rate is equal to or more than the ventricular rate, the wavelet will take over, and it bases on the morphology, it will decide whether to withhold the detection or to go ahead with the detection.
Where was like बड़े हो गए थे.
So in this example, PR logic plus wavelet. So as you can see, it is mentioned here that PR logic was unable to withhold or was unable to declare that it's an SVT. And then the device looked at this criteria, whether the atrial rate is higher than or equal to ventricular rate. So in this case, which is higher? And upon reaching the detection, device is applied and wavelet evaluates this result.
If somebody is there and not muted, just mute yourself.
Hi, Aryan.
Meenakshi, you will have to do it. You are the
yeah, sir, I am just doing it. Yeah, I did it. So yeah, as this particular example shows how the PR logic and wavelet functions together and the device, and you can see the type SVT because of wavelet, it is withholding the detection. So that was about the PR logic and the wavelet. Coming to the onset. So onset, looking at this plot diagram, one rhythm begins gradually, whereas the second rhythm, you see, it is happening abruptly. So the onset feature prevents the detection of sinus tachycardia as VT by evaluating the acceleration of the ventricular rate. So if the ventricular rate increases gradually, as seen during the sinus tachycardia, the device classifies the rhythm as a SVT due to onset. So it will look at for the gradual onset or the abrupt onset of the arrhythmia. So in this example, as you can see, the rate is accelerating and it is going into the VT zone and it is going quite gradually. So device has detected this as a gradual onset and it has withheld the therapy, and the type shown here is SVT onset. So all these examples that I am showing is actually from the programmer screen. So if you ever happen to interrogate the ICD devices, you would see all these plot diagram and the EGFs. So how does it do it? First thing, it operates in the VT zone and it is nominally off. So when we turn this on, we also have to program the percentage. So when the device, so during an episode, the device continuously analyzes the average of the current four ventricular intervals to the average of the previous four ventricular intervals. And it compares the difference between these two average rates to the programmed onset percentage. So if the percent change is greater than the programmed percentage, then the onset is met. That means the VT is detected. So the change between the two average, the percent change between the two average should be greater than the programmed percentage. Hence the device will say that it's
relevant.
So as seen, so there's also consideration here. For example, if we are aware that a particular patient has an ability to go into a ventricular tachycardia while doing an exercise, then we recommend that we avoid putting this therapy on, putting this feature on. Because as you can see here, here the rate was 1:1. It was tracking 1:1. And then suddenly this patient went into VT. But what the device sees is it is going gradual. The ventricular rate is changing gradually. But here you can clearly see that there is a dissociation between the A rate and the ventricular rate. So this is one of the conditions where we recommend not to turn on this feature for a patient who is prone to develop a VT while doing exercise. Talking about stability, Also, this works in the VT zone only. As we can see here, again, the ventricular rates are quite irregular as well. Your the atrial rate and the atrial rates are faster than the ventricular rate. So, as by the name, it checks the stability of the ventricular intervals. If the ventricular intervals are irregular, it will withheld the therapy for that particular episode. So again, this is nominally off. And when you turn it on, it will ask you to select the stability interval. So nominally, we select 40 or 50. So that means when reaching the third, when the VT counter reaches third beat, it will try to compare from the previous three beat. And if any of the three beat, any of the difference is greater than this 40 milliseconds, the device will reset the counter. That means on the every third beat, it will reset the counter. So in this case, it will not allow for that particular rhythm to reach the NID, that is number of intervals to detect. So in this case, this feature is withholding the detection for an irregular V2V interval. So you will note that it is mentioned reset stability. So we will get to see this in the decision channel. So again, a consideration for this particular feature is that never to program this stability interval lesser, 30, because sometimes the true VTs are also irregular in nature. Considering this is a true ventricular for this patient, and because we have programmed the stability interval of 30 milliseconds, then inappropriately the device will withheld the therapy for a true VT. So in this, for this particular patient, we might consider programming a little higher stability interval. That is the consideration. So coming to the next part, so I'll be talking about the smart shock technology, which is now available in the newer generation devices. Here you can see on the left, this is an example from the SCADEF trial. They have taken the sample episodes for rates above 188 beats per minute. And it has been shown that there are few instances where the shock was given for the rhythm, let's say SVT, for the rhythm NSVT, and also for the non-arrhythmic events, which is noise, oversensing the noise. So this noise would be probably because of T-wave oversensing, which we were discussing at last time. And also it could be a lead fracture related noise. So these were the inappropriate shock that were given in this particular episode. And then we had from Protecta onwards. So Protecta is our device, so in which we had a smart shock technology. I'll describe what is the smart shock technology in the next slide. With the help of this, at a nominal settings, we could avoid giving shock to the patients approximately 30% less for the because of smart shock, and about 24% less because of AT. Okay, I just got a message that the Zoom meeting might end. Okay, so we'll just
repeat login in the same link. No problem.
Sure. Okay. So the smart shock technology, it includes six exclusive algorithms that discriminates the true arrhythmia from the arrhythmic and the non-arrhythmic events. So we have already described the wavelet plus PR logic. And since we have also seen the SVT limit, which was about 260 milliseconds, so with that lower number, it allows the discriminator to also work in the VF zone. And we also have learned the confirmation plus in the last session, where it confirms whether the arrhythmia is still present after the after an ATP, right? So on that basis, we can avoid inappropriate shock if the episode has been terminated with that one set of ATP in the VF zone, that is ATP during charging. But now what about the non-arrhythmic event? What does device has in it to avoid the inappropriate shock for the non-arrhythmic event? So there are three things. One is T-wave discrimination. Second is lead integrity alert. So a lead integrity alert will just give an alert. It is not capable of withholding the therapy, but it will provide an early alert saying that there are some odd parameters which has been detected. And third is lead noise discrimination and alert. So lead noise discrimination is capable of withholding the therapy for an episode where the noise has been detected. And all these six features are nominally on. So first is this. I'll just explain it briefly. I'll not go much into the algorithms. So it is the first and the only T-wave discrimination, which works on the frequency as well as the amplitude. It is fully automatic. What it does is, in the older generation devices, the signals are filtered to isolate the R wave, but still it may oversense the T wave, as you can see it here. In this particular EGM, as V-tip to V-ring, your T wave is quite tall, right? But now in the newer generation devices, we have a differential filter. What it does is, for an R wave, which is a high frequency signal, it will increase the amplitude for that. And for a T wave signal, which generally has a lower frequency, it will attenuate that. So it kind of create a pattern, R and P pattern, it kind of create a ratio. Based on this, it determines that there is a T wave oversensing and it is capable of withholding the therapy. Remember, it will not eliminate the problem of T wave oversensing, but it is capable of withholding the inappropriate shock due to T-wave oversense. As we can see here in this particular example, the top EGM is A-tip to A-ring. The second EGM is RV-tip to RV-ring. And in the marker channel, we see that there are a lot of events seen in the ventricular EGM markers, right? So what exactly it is sensing? This you can see, this is T-wave. This is the true R-wave. But yet again, it is seeing the T wave. So consistently, this has been sensing the T wave. And because the intervals are short between the true R wave and the T wave, so that interval is probably falling in the VF zone. So whenever it's falling in the VF zone, it is marking it as FS, right? So if this feature was not present, probably this patient would have received a shock, right? But because this feature is available, at the time of detection, NID, it will say TW. It will mark it as TW, which denotes that the device has withheld the therapy because of T-wave oversensing discriminator criteria. So that's how we will be able to see this on the programmer, right, in the EGM. Second is the lead integrity suit. So it combines two algorithms that detects alerts and withhold the inappropriate therapy for lead fractures. So basically, as we all know, the device that senses the rhythms for the detection purpose, it looks at the near field region, right? But when detecting for any noise, the device considers far-field EGM. So similarly, in this case, what the device does, it kind of compares the near-field EGM and the far-field EGM. Imagine if this is a true VT, so both the EGM would look same. But if there is a noise which has been seen in the near-field EGM, and if you look at the far-field EGM, there is no noise being seen. So it compares between the two and look for this change. if they are not same, it will say that it's a noise which has been detected. So that's how it compares the near field and the far field and determines whether the noise is available, is present or not. So here is a detailed example here. So lead noise oversensing is typically isolated to the near field sensing signal. The far field AGM is analyzed to determine if the event sensed on the near field AGM is noise or a true ventricular event. So on basis of this, it withhelds the detection for a noise rhythm. So here it will mark as N. So N denotes that it is RV lead noise discriminator, which is withholding the detection. We will also get this observation in the screen when we interrogate on the first quick look to screen that there is an alert because of RV lead integrity warning. So what are these warning? What are the criteria it looks at? It looks at the high rate NSVT episodes which are less than 220 milliseconds. It also looks at the out of range impedance for more than 3000 millivolts. And then for sensing integrity counter, if it is more than or equal to 30 days. So there are some criteria which it needs to meet before giving an alert. And once this alert is given, it extends the VF NID to 30/40. So by doing this, what are we trying to achieve? It's just that we all know that the noise, when it occurs, it doesn't sustain for a longer time. So by increasing the NID, we might somewhere avoid providing, giving an inappropriate shock. So that was the reason. I'm not going through this again, but just to reiterate that this too is also included in the smart shock technology. And also the confirmation plus. So with that, this was the performance which was shown. So it reduced or it avoided shock for 24% due to ATP and 30% due to smart shock technology. So in the pain-free SST trial where it used the SST parameters, smart shock technology 2.0 parameters at the nominal settings, it showed that 98.5% of the patients with dual chamber and triple chamber devices they could avoid the inappropriate shock, and for the single chamber ICD it was 97.5% of the patients. I'll just briefly talk about the Vizia AF, which is our latest device. It's a single chamber ICD, but still it is capable of giving the details on the AF, so AF burden. So it enables physician to continuously monitor, diagnose, and better manage the AF patients. So it's just the algorithm which is additional, but whole component in the device and the lead remains the same. So it works on R2R variability criteria on determining if the variability of AF. So variability threshold is programmable. So as we can see here in the programmer strip, that there is R2R variability and it looks for CAN to RV coil EGM. Again in the plot, we can see that there is a lot of variability in the ventricular rate. So it kind of creates the Lorentz plot within the device. If I just compare the normal sinus rhythm to the AF, the normal sinus rhythm, all the plots are centered at one place. Whereas for patients who have atrial fibrillation with the irregular ventricular rate, the plots are all across the place. So this is how the device kind of differentiate between the AF and normal sinus rhythm. And so this was the data from this algorithm, which says that if a patient has 100 episodes of AF, 95 episodes will be detected by the device. That means 95% episode sensitivity. If a patient has 100 hours of AF, 95 hours will be detected by the device. So it's 95% burden sensitivity. And with the predictive positive predictive value of 96% for the burden. So this was my last slide. If any questions, I'll be happy to answer.
It was very nice, Meenakshi. It was really very clear and lucid. I'll first ask some, I'll summarize what you've said and then ask some questions.
Sure.
For all students who are listening for this for the first time, about discrimination from supraventricular tachycardia and ventricular tachycardia, which we read in ECG, and now we are looking at it on our devices. The purpose is, obviously, we want that the patient's ventricular arrhythmia is treated by the defibrillator. At the same time, inappropriate treatment is not given. And for that, for an engineer, for a device engineer, he has to do a lot of thinking. So what are the problems that can give rise to inappropriate shocks? One is, patient does not have ventricular tachycardia, but has tachycardia other than ventricular tachycardia, which could be atrial fibrillation, atrial flutter, sinus tachycardia, other supraventricular tachycardias. And for that, similar to what we think, the engineers have done programming so that they are able to discriminate the supraventricular tachycardia from the ventricular tachycardia. You can hear me, right?
Yes, sir.
Okay. So, what are those? So, one is looking at the P and the R relationship. First is looking at whether your ventricular rate is higher than the atrial rate. That's what we do usually. So, if the ventricular rate is higher than the atrial rate, automatically it is ventricular tachycardia. If it is a one-to-one tachycardia, meaning every P wave is associated with the R wave, then the question arises whether it is an SVT or not, isn't it? So, for that, you have different parameters by which the device can detect. Now, all this SVT discrimination stays within the VT zone. So, it is not applied above a certain rate, which is VF zone. So, if your tachycardia is in the VF zone, all these parameters are not applied. Similarly, there is a rate timeout interval beyond which, again, these parameters are not applied. So, if a SVT continues for a long time, then it will be treated as VT. Just correct me, Meenakshi, if I am wrong.
Yes, sir, you're correct for the timeout. But as I said, the SVT limit is up to 260 milliseconds, so it can still apply in the VF zone.
But that is programmable, right?
Yes, sir. That's programmable.
It's programmable. So usually, I think in the VF zone, as much as we know, at a heart rate of about 220 or above, we don't want this discriminators to kick in. So if you have a very fast supraventricular tachycardia or AF, you don't want to risk missing it. So generally it is programmed such that it is there, all these discriminators are there for slow VTs, but not for fast VTs or VF. Even if it is an SVT, we prefer to treat them. So it is, whether it is atrial flutter fibrillation, whether it is sinus tachycardia or whether it is other SVT. So all that is identified using these discriminators. The second thing you mentioned in discrimination was onset. And in that onset, we look at what is the percentage change that is happening in a beat of three beats or four beats, right?
Four beats.
So every consecutive four beats, if the change is how much? How much is the program change for diagnosis?
81%.
If the change is more than 81%, so the drop is more than 19% with every four beats, then we say that is not sinus tachycardia. So that way we get the sinus tachycardia out of picture. Otherwise, we treat it as sinus tachycardia. So the device does not treat the arrhythmia, considering it is sinus tachycardia. The second thing is stability, which you said. And in stability, we see beat-to-beat change in the RR intervals. So the sensed RRs, on average sensed RR between three consecutive beats, if the change is more than 40 milliseconds, then we know that the arrhythmia is not stable enough to call it VT. This is based on the premise that atrial fibrillation is unstable and ventricular tachycardia is stable. So we want to treat a stable rhythm. So if the RR variation is less than 30 milliseconds, then we accept it as VT and treat it as VT. If the RR variation is more than 40 milliseconds, then we say that it is atrial fibrillation and the device does not ring. Again, this has to be used with very caution and it has to be applied only in the slower zones, not in the faster zones. So this was for stability, onset stability. Then you also mentioned to begin with on morphology. Now, morphology is used mainly in single chamber defibrillators because you cannot use PR logic. You cannot use other CT discriminators there. And for morphology, the cutoff is how much, Meenakshi?
Seventy percent match. And that is programmable.
Now,
yeah.
Correct. It is programmable. So when the device is collecting local EGMs, say multiple EGMs, there will be morphology for the EGM. So it will collect this sinus rhythm and it will know what the sinus rhythm morphology of the EGM is. So if that morphology varies by more than 70%, it is very similar to what you look on ECG. On an ECG, a sinus tachycardia will look like a sinus tachycardia. A VT will look like a VT. So the EGM, basically local EGM is also doing the same and computer just can, it can recognize your face to detect your face for logging in into your mobile. It can definitely detect the morphology of the local EGMs and tell if this is a VT or a SVT. And that morphology, the criteria is 70%. So that was another thing which was discussed. Now, the last thing was not arrhythmias, but T waves are lead integrity problems. And that is a totally different thing. So for T wave oversensing, there is a different algorithm. And for lead integrity, there's a different algorithm. For lead integrity, if you look at impedance, sudden change in impedances beyond the range, sensing near field versus far field sensing on the lead. So all this will help us in discriminate. And then smart shock technology. And then very beautifully, you also mentioned about this detection of atrial fibrillation in which Lorentz plot diagram, which was also new to me, Lorentz plot diagram was used to detect how the beats are distributed. I'd like to know a little bit more about this Lorentz plot also. But before that, I want to ask, how is the usual programming done? And what is it that is dangerous to do it while programming SVT discriminators? So Govind, if you can just clarify the programming part, because all of our students are going to implant ICDs when they start their practice. So they should know all these programming aspects also. Otherwise, I see most of the times cardiologists will implant, but they have no idea about what is happening. And so if Govind can clarify, what sure. is it that we avoid when programming this SVT discriminators?
Sure, sir. Yeah. So, point is, important things are, as Meenakshi pointed out, and actually you also mentioned while you were describing it. So, you know, the two things are important. One is the use of the stability criteria and also the onset criteria. And yes, during atrial fibrillation, the RR interval is going to be irregular. And we program a criteria for that irregularity, which is maybe 40, 50 milliseconds RR interval variation. But there could be a possible patient that can have a VT that itself is varying by that much cycle length, or a patient can have a polymorphic VT in the VT zone where the RR interval is varying. So if this is programmed on for such a patient, it might miss a VT itself. So that is why actually nominally this feature is off, and you would want to program it on only if there is a problem either with the wavelet or the PR logic criteria, which are more reliable and they are less likely to miss out a VT. That is one. And the second thing is the onset criteria. Again, as Meenakshi pointed out, there are some of your patients that get a VT induced at a rate slightly faster than the sinus tachycardia rate when the patient is doing some activity. So for the device, you know, transition from the sinus tachycardia rate to the VT rate, if the rate is not too different, then it would consider this as a gradual onset and withhold therapy for that gradual onset, although that happened to be a VT. One example was shown by Meenakshi. And so that is dangerous. So then it is not a good idea to program it on for that patient onset. And once again, for this reason, the onset criteria is nominally off. Wavelet criteria is reasonably reliable. It might still miss an SVT and deliver an inappropriate shock, but it is very less likely to miss a VT. So, you know, we can rely more on the wavelet criteria. And for some reason, if the wavelet criteria is not giving an appropriate outcome that we are looking for, then we could consider switching on the onset criteria or the stability criteria. So that's the only important thing that you may want to keep in mind. And as Meenakshi pointed out, if it is a CRT-D device, you know, the device has an automatic way of accumulating or collecting the wavelet morphology template. And for a CRT-D, because you're pacing all the time, it is not going to see the intrinsic, because it has to store the intrinsic morphology. So it will not have an option or opportunity to do that. So every time when the patient comes for a follow-up, we need to program or collect the template for the morphology match. So that is the other point. And coming to the single chamber ICD detecting an atrial fibrillation, which is based on the Lorentz plot criteria. Yeah, it is not used for SVT discrimination, actually. So it is used only for detecting atrial arrhythmia and give to the physician an information about the presence and the burden of atrial fibrillation for the patient. So in that device, the objective is not use that criteria for discriminating SVT from a VT. It's more for monitoring. So that's the roundup of these things. So if you have any further questions.
Thank you so much, Govind. Now, about the Lorentz plot itself, maybe yes. I missed what she was telling. She said for sinus tachycardia, it is a single dot. And then for other arrhythmias, the plot is different. So I just wanted to know, how is this plot done? Based on what parameters? It is rate, morphology, or what is it?
No, actually, it is looking at the RR interval of two successive RR events. So it's looking at the current one and it compares it with the previous one, what is the RR interval, and it puts it up in a plot with that, Meenakshi described, the variation of the current two RR intervals compared to the previous two RR intervals. So it's not the comparison of the regular RR interval that you will look at when you're also looking at the conventional RR interval variability for the for consideration of atrial fibrillation. It looks at the variation of the current pair compared to the previous two. Mm. So that is how it calculates. And then it collects it for every 2 minute intervals. So that is what it is looking at. And then it makes a plot.
For sinus rhythm, if you get variations in the sinus rate, there will be a single dot because the rate change is not that much.
Yes, that is where it will be almost centering around the middle of that plot.
Correct. Now, if it is VT, what will happen for a VT?
No, it is not looking at VT. This is only for, diagnosing atrial fibrillation.
Yeah, so I understand. Other arrhythmias are also there. The device does not know if it is VT, AF or anything. So what would happen to that Lorentz plot while
so
it is collected?
What it is actually
used for therapy.
Yes, it is not used for therapy, nor is it used for SVT discrimination. All it is, all it will do is, it will look whether if the patient has an atrial fibrillation or not. That's it. It will not say whether it's a sinus tachycardia. It will not say whether it's an atrial tachycardia, or it will not say whether it's an atrial flutter. It will only look at if it is an atrial fibrillation based on this. And also, the device will not give us the Lorentz plot. The Lorentz plot is just it's based on this. And there is a mathematical calculation. And based on this, the device gives itself a score for that. The weightage of score.
Correct.
and then that score itself is not programmable. All we need to do is switch on, do we want to detect atrial fibrillation and monitor it. So we just switch on.
Yeah. Hours.
Yes. Yes.
You know, hours of atrial fibrillation based on this 2 minutes data collection.
Yes, exactly, sir. So it accumulates all that and it accumulates.
So when
and
you look at that, actually.
And then it also stores that electrogram, which you can decide to store. Let's say more than 6 minutes, store that event. Then it will store that and you can review that.
Perfect. Now, when we look at that Lorentz plot, just out of interest, I wanted to know that there is a scatter plot that is there. In atrial fibrillation, it's all scattered all over. Points are scattered all over.
Yes.
Now, that scatter, how is it plotted? Like, what are the two axes on which this points go at multiple points? It, like, you can understand sinus rhythm staying one. If it is on, if it is a linear plot, you would understand
right. That
it is going to and forth. But this is like a two-dimensional plot, right?
Yeah, exactly. So, it has
fall into the four quadrants. Yeah, four quadrants. Right. How does it fall?
Yeah, so it is now, you know, it's a four quadrants. So it is looking at the current pair difference, RR interval difference. Let us say it is the difference, let us say, is 150 milliseconds, for example.
Hmm.
Then that is one point now, right now. And then it looks simultaneously.
150 positive will go on the right up corner.
Yes.
150 minus will go in the left lower corner.
Right. Simultaneously, it is looking at what was the difference in the previous pair. So that may be positive or negative. So then these two are coordinates. So that's one point. The coordinate of the RR interval now and the previous one.
Okay.
It may be positive or negative.
If you have change is 150 now and minus 150 in the previous one, then it is putting a plot in that quadrant.
Yes, exactly.
If it is plus 150 now, plus 200 now, it is in that quadrant.
Exactly.
If it is minus 150, minus 200, it is in that part, correct?
Exactly, yeah.
Oh,
so then it'll be scattered all over all the four quadrants. Yeah, all
that
the four
is how
quadrants.
It scatters, yeah.
Yes, yeah.
So it
and then it gives itself a score. And for evaluating, it gives itself a score, which is actually determined by statistical research. So that score itself is not programmable. But all we need to do is switch on AF detection. So it's based on that.
Perfect. So it was really a wonderful session today and a very important session. Very difficult to remember, recollect over a long period of time. But for students, they should know that 20% of the shocks are inappropriate. 21% of the shocks are inappropriate. All these features help in reducing those inappropriate therapies. And there are some situations where they may not be able to do it with these features also. And in that situation, we have to get around by, like, suppose there is T-wave oversensing. If you cannot get by this T-wave oversensing algorithms, maybe lead repositioning is needed. If there is an incessant slow VT going on, and you can't do anything, either it gets undetected and not treated, or it gets overtreated, then you have to treat the VT per se by giving drugs or by doing ablation. So these are the ways to get around these things. Obviously, if there is a lead integrity alert, then the lead needs to be corrected. If it is a defib lead, obviously in a defibrillator lead, you're getting a lead integrity alert. Then you look at whether the alert is on the pacing file or the defib file. Depending upon that, you may choose to just put in another pace sense lead rather than changing the entire defibrillator lead. So these are some things which we should know in terms of managing a device patient. One of us, if we can look at what is VT storm, because that is a very common and favorite question that is asked. Definition of VT storm and management of VT storm. So one of the students, if we can take that up, that will be a very good idea. Any other questions are there? Anybody has any questions? Okay, that's very nice. So thanks a lot, Meenakshi, and thanks a lot, Govind, both of you.
Thank you, sir.
We have still one more session to go next time.
Yes, it's about the CRT algorithms, the special CRT algorithms.
Okay. Thank you. So I think amongst all of them, stepwise, you brought us from single chamber pacemakers to dual chamber pacemakers to just ICD technology, ICD detection and therapies, to today how discrimination is done in order to prevent inappropriate treatment by the ICD. And now we'll move into CRTs next time.
Sure. Yes, sir. Yeah.
And if you want, you can leave, just hand over to Sachin. That's all.
So yeah, that's sure. Me, Dr. Sachin, the host now.
Yes, ma'am. Yeah.
Thank you. Thank you so much.
Thank you, sir. We will log off. Thank you very much for the opportunity. See you next week. Thank you so much.
Thank you.